Was that just recently?
Yeah, a couple days ago.
Oh my gosh.
So what we'll do is at the beginning, we'll need to say what the name of, what the address is, just so we can tie the audio.
Are you
going to
start on Lafayette?
And
yeah,
you
and I'll name these.
And then go to Indiana and then back to Lafayette? That's what you told me. So remember I asked you about history and you say you remember they lived in Lafayette.
Yeah.
Then you moved to Indiana and then you moved back to Lafayette. You said they rented, they lived in Lafayette, then they decided to rent out the house.
Yes.
And they moved to Indiana, but then the people didn't pay their rent, so they
went back to
again.
Yeah.
You remember that?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
Gosh.
See, I
that would be very disappointing, you know?
So you have to go back to houses.
But this isn't the first place we started.
Does it need to be?
No,
I don't know what order
They're just kind of however they got loaded.
So I just have a clip of all the different places, you know, one clip of each, and we'll name the clip once we figure out what house it is and play it, and then we'll know.
That's 8014.
Yeah, that's correct.
Yeah. So what we thought we would do is just play them. A lot of them don't have sound. Unfortunately, I goofed up. But we'll capture what you guys say about them, as you can see.
But before we start, you really ought to get up close to see this, because this is going to be very interesting.
You're
going to
be
one closer than I am, because you really,
you
want
your phone number there, Mark, and I'll put my phone.
I remember that house.
Is it going?
It was there upstairs to begin with.
Okay, let's go.
When they moved in?
I don't understand.
The rent moved in upstairs here. Her name was Mustard. Mom and Dad moved downstairs, and she was upstairs.
That's
and
right,
Mustard
and Uncle.
Uncle.
Yeah, that's right.
I had to bring the mail up to her
when
it came.
And that was the Olsons lived over there next door.
Yeah,
that's right. So what was the address now?
8014 Coles.
8014.
I think your dad can name us later on. As long as we say it on the tape.
Look at the people coming out of the house now.
Did you ring the doorbell or something? Did you ring the doorbell?
No.
We stopped and we're looking at the house and taking pictures, and they sort of came out to see what we're doing. Can we help you?
They were from Nigeria.
So what do y'all remember from that house?
You were playing Monopoly in the basement with your friends.
Correct.
And there was coal at one side, and somebody drew a picture on the wall.
Yep.
So the coal would cover it. We changed furnaces, and we took some kind of stuff and slapped it on the furnace because it went from coal to something else.
Well, it was coal with forced air, and then when we first moved in there, they changed it to hot water. And then it was still coal and hot water, and then they converted it to oil. And if you remember the porch in the back, you went down the stairs, there was two great big tanks that had oil in it, that was oil burner in the furnace.
Now that I don't remember.
Okay. Yeah. But we lived on the first floor, and there was,
Mr. and Uncle, and then Aunt Emma moved in upstairs.
Yeah, and Uncle Louie and Ronnie lived upstairs, that's right.
And they moved to Hermitage Avenue.
I don't know exactly, but these people were very interesting that you're looking at there. Very friendly.
Did you get to go inside?
No, we didn't ask, nor did they offer. But the house is in not great repair.
It looks good.
But if you were to see the underneath here, the ceiling on the porch, it's full of holes. See there, you can see it. See it?
Oh yeah, that looks bad.
I noticed your bedroom, I remember your bedroom was under the stairs,
bed. Yep, that's right.
And you go up the stairs and then there was a separate entrance to one of the bedrooms, the one in the front.
Yep.
So, did they rent the room out or something?
I don't really.
Because it had the two entrances.
I don't know. But the one went upstairs and then one went into the first floor.
And the kitchen downstairs was remodeled with cabinets, and the one upstairs had a pantry.
Yep.
And because there wasn't a pantry on the first floor that was taken out, so the bedroom was bigger. And they had, what do they call it, where people hang their clothes?
Wardrobe.
Wardrobe in there instead.
Yeah.
Mom had that big round table with the funny legs underneath that came out.
And Pop built the garage in the back. Do you remember that?
Yes.
And Uncle Lee was helping him with the floor, and he did something on his leg so he couldn't move, so Pop had to finish the floor by himself, which was a lot of work.
I remember when they wanted to go somewhere to buy some alcohol, and Ronald and I were there pestering, wanting to go with, but they didn't want to tell us where they were going to go. So they gave us money for popsicles and sent us to the store. When we got back, they were gone. Isn't that where I called you go-go to? Because I couldn't say Gordon.
Yeah. And the people across the street had a television set. They were the first ones on this end of the block that had a TV, and I used to sit in the front room and look at the 10-inch screen across the way. And then Pop finally bought a television set, but it was a few years later.
Yeah, he said something about he wanted to wait until it was perfected.
Yes.
Is that where they had a piano?
We had a piano upstairs, and then they put one downstairs. In the basement, there was a piano. But because it was damp, the keys would stick after a while.
Mm-hmm. So did Grandpa play the piano?
Oh, yeah, he played piano, violin, and accordion.
Wow. He taught himself.
Yeah.
Wow.
Organ, too. When he was in Sweden, he played the organ.
I never remember his playing any of those.
I remember him playing you played accordion, remember? We had a small 24 bass and then a 180 bass or 120 bass, but he played that. And for some reason, I have in my head that he played a violin, that I saw him playing a violin, and I thought that was on Indiana. We lived on 8048 Indiana.
But Mary Lou had a violin, it's possible.
Yeah, maybe she borrowed or let him, that might be okay. Here, I bet you might. I don't know if you know this. Do you remember the story about Mary Lou and Ruby and Betty? We were at their house, Uncle Louie's house, ever since you brought up. And Mary Lou played the piano, and Betty was the oldest one, and she really liked horse around. Anyways, we were sitting there, the folks and Uncle Louie and Auntie Emma, and they had a piano and a violin, and Mary Lou and Betty said that they could talk by telecommunications, and I didn't know what that meant. And so they told Mary Lou, go in the kitchen. And so then Betty asked my mom and says, what would you like Mary Lou to do? Think of something, and mom said, play the violin. So then they asked, Mary Lou, come on back, sit down in the chair, shut your eyes. Okay. I don't know if you remember this, but I thought this sticks in my head. So what did Betty do? She would go like, she stood behind Mary Lou and went like this. Kept doing this, but slight variations, and I didn't realize at the time. And she was spelling out, play violin by doing, you know. And then after a while she quit, and Mary Lou had her eyes shut the whole time, and then she'd go like she was just coming out of a deep trance. And she took the violin and started to play it. I remember mom's like, and at first I didn't understand, but after I thought about it, I remember how she did this and then go down once in a while. I thought,
wow, that's pretty interesting.
Yeah, it was cool. Yeah. Anyways, those were the still going back to 8014.
So is that still playing?
Still at 8014,
oh, okay.
Yes.
Do you want to fast forward to another?
Yeah, we could.
House?
Oh, it's done, right?
Well, it looks like it's still.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I mean, so what was the name of this one? 8014 Coles.
Do you remember when we lived there, you could go down 79th Street and all the way to the end of the lake, and that's where the trolley cars reversed and went the other direction?
Yeah.
You can't go down there anymore. South Shore Drive doesn't go, after South Shore Drive, you can't go any further. You have to go some odd direction. So it doesn't go down to the lake anymore, and I felt kind of bad about that.
When you're on 79th Street heading towards South Shore Drive, did you pass the water fountain for horses and people, or is that
gone?
We didn't.
That's gone, too. Yeah, I thought that was such a cool thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, what's this? Oh, this is an artesian.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That was a nice house.
So what was the address here?
100-something.
Artesian? Is it the only artesian?
14.
Yeah, artesian.
Yeah.
And that was a house Pop built.
Yeah, and you helped him.
Yeah. Yeah. And I was pointing out that under this, remember there was a coal storage that you entered it from the basement?
Yeah.
Underneath the front porch.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that was kind of a cool thing.
That was his bomb shelter.
Yes.
Bomb
well,
shelter.
That's true.
Well, it could be.
Awesome.
And there's a fireplace downstairs, too.
Yeah.
Uncle Louie would tell the Vesco stories down there.
Really?
Yeah. Harry and Shulker's met.
Yeah.
They had dinner down there, and they'd go sit by the fireplace, and they'd tell these really good stories.
Wow.
I think there was a piano down there.
I thought it was upstairs in the living room. I could be wrong.
No, because I think they put it down there.
They would
and then
down,
they,
I don't know.
They knew that it would not come up the stairs, and it was going to be there because of
while they were building?
Yeah.
Wow.
It's like building your boat in the basement.
That's why.
That's where the hot dog stand was. That area.
Yeah, Snyder's. Yeah.
I remember they tried to give you a birthday surprise party.
Yes.
That's why I said I thought the piano was upstairs, because I seem to remember you banging on the keys to get them to leave the living room so everybody could come in. But they came in the back door. It didn't work.
Oh, yeah.
I don't remember where the piano was closed.
Yeah, that's... I can be wrong. I just think
no, I just don't
that's
remember.
That's what I was... It's just what you remember. I just...
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you had your car, the Angela?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That little black hat you wore and the arrows came out on the side of the car.
It was a Ford Anglia 1948 model. Yeah. And when you wanted to turn left, you put this little thing on the steering wheel, you push it over, and on the side of the car, just what Diane said, a little flag about this long would lift up with a light in it.
Wow.
And then when you flip it back, it would come down. It had one on each side that way. I thought it was kind of cool. But it had a cloth roof, and when it rained, it would leak. And the, let's see. The trunk door came down, and there were two straps, so you could put big suitcases and things, the hauling thing. And there was no radio in it. But if you remember this fellow we met, Edgar, yesterday, or the day before, he had a radio because he was going to put in this Packard that he bought, and he said it didn't fit what I wanted. I said, sure. Now, that radio was probably the size of four shoeboxes together. It was a huge thing. And I hooked it up underneath. So the dash was a tiny little thing, big thing, but I could never get it to play right because it was 6 volts, and I don't know what the problem was. But it played occasionally, but not the way, and I couldn't find, I didn't want to drill a hole in the body to put an antenna in, so I had an antenna underneath the cloth roof. It wasn't that great. So I finally gave up with it. Oh!
Is it done? Or?
Well, shut down.
Yeah, it's done. That's the end of that one. What's the name of that?
10014 Artesian. There was a lot more to talk.
We had a dog there too. Remember, it was a
yeah,
cocker spaniel.
Yeah, cocker spaniel.
Bite.
Fudge
I
was his name or something.
I don't know.
We had two dogs. We had two.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
Oh.
Yeah, Mom got rid of the cocker spaniel.
Yeah, I remember that one day was.
She brought it to a place where they sell dogs, gave
yep.
them $10.
Okay.
Yeah, I remember that. Now they say that.
Yeah. Then we looked in the paper and we found a black one. Can't remember what breed it was. And Dad took me over to pick it out, and I only had $7, so I had to pay for it. And the man took the $7 and got the dog.
This is a little shorter one.
Well, it's 93rd place.
Patrick, that's it.
Yes, that's right. You remember. The railroad tracks are gone.
Yeah.
And they went by with the freight trains.
Yeah.
I got so used to having the bedroom there and all that noise, I could sleep through a thunder shower. No problem at all.
Yeah. And remember, the dog would look out the window because there wasn't that high hedge in front.
Yeah.
So was that dog Grandpa's dog or your dog?
It was everybody's dog.
Yeah.
He didn't have a preference. Although I think he liked Mom, because when she went out, he'd sleep on her bed. So that you could see that little indentation.
That was the kitchen there, those two windows. Mm-hmm. There was the back door. And then there was that breezeway where the television set was. And there's one part of the garage. And then, as Diane pointed out, the other side had, but they put the doors gone.
Oh, yeah.
That's why they did that. I wonder if they filled up that little hole in the floor, too.
Do you remember there was a woman that lived down the street a little ways, and from a distance she looked very young, and when you got up close to her, she realized she was very old, and she would drink a lot?
Oh, yeah, she used to go out and walk at night around the neighborhood.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, and we were invited over to some type of a party where they sell things, I don't know what it was called, jewelry, and she walked over there, and the woman teased her, said, "You have this fabulous coat. Fur coat, why don't you wear it? You went home, put it on." I walked across the street wearing it. Same person.
Yeah.
What was the name of that one?
1643 West 93rd Place.
Well, you remembered. I know it's 93rd Place, but
I had to remember for Steve when he went on the internet. And I asked Nancy for something after she gave me three.
And the street that goes alongside the house doesn't go through up to 95th anymore. It dead ends just in the middle of it.
Yes.
I'm
gonna put the name of that one on there too. 93rd, is that easy enough?
93rd Place. I can't tell what that is.
It looks like the garage on 93rd
Place.
Yeah,
that was another house.
Is it the same?
No.
That's where we lived when I got married, I remember that.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah, I think.
Or was it on Artesian? I think we were on Artesian then, because Pop took my car. I had a 50 Chevrolet that was nicer than his car that I bashed up several times. Yeah.
Yeah, it was on 80 when we lived on Coles Avenue. Came running home one time. He didn't know it was wrong, so he pulled all the wires and cut them. That I remember.
Maybe it wasn't.
Yeah, it was on Artesian.
So it was when you got married?
Oh, that was from that house there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what it was.
Yeah.
Okay.
I can't think of anything special that happened there.
Except it had a half bath with a sliding door, remember?
Yeah.
And I thought that was kind of cool. It didn't
swing
in the hall or into the bathroom.
They played like that was an elevator.
Yes, that's right.
Did
you go in there and shut the door?
Yeah. For Christmas.
That was the first time we lived in a house with two bathrooms, too.
That's right.
Yeah.
That was another plus.
Yeah.
No basement, though.
I was telling him there was a house across the way with two old men lived there. Once they had a big extension ladder they were trying to put up in the front. I don't know what they were going to fix. And I watched, and somebody must have spent 20, 30 minutes trying to put this ladder up. You know, two guys just twisting and turning, and they're never going to get it up the way they're doing it. And there was the dining room. Remember, we had that little... I thought that was kind of cool.
He used to put a fan in the window
so
he could draw the air through.
Yeah.
I think Dad had a special architect to design it for that corner.
Because it was triangular shaped.
Yeah.
I know Mom took a piece of paper and folded it like a triangle and tried to draw a house plan on it.
Yeah.
Striking. I remember going there when they were building the house, too, with Dad.
Yeah.
He'd drive down and we'd go and look it over.
Yeah, he would check on the house coming along with the brickworks and the other.
I used to have to babysit for the people next door.
The ones on the left?
Yeah, that house.
Yeah. They had, I remember, a big Buick, two-door sedan, and I thought, boy, that looks sleek. They parked it outside. I don't think they had a garage at the time.
Yeah, the little girls used to visit Mom often, Dad often. And yeah, one day they came over and said, we had popcorn for supper tonight. Mom didn't like that. She thought that was terrible. I can't think of anything else.
No, I nor I.
Is it
Well, there was a bakery up in 95th that was great to go to, remember?
Oh, yeah. I used to take the train to work, and I'd stop on payday and bring home some biscuits. And there was one left. I apologize for eating it on payday. I told her it was for you to eat, but she felt so guilty.
I think that's where, you remember Lillian?
Yeah.
When she came from Sweden with Pear, well, Per went back to Sweden, and she ended up staying there with the folks. Yeah,
yeah, that's right. Yeah. And then she met the fellow she finally married.
Yeah.
I don't know how that, he worked at Argonne National Laboratories.
Yeah.
But I don't know how they met.
It might have been in night school. I'm not sure.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, she was teaching Swedish. I mean, English.
That's right.
I think. Yeah, that's exactly. I think it was Berlitz or something.
No.
I guess it's just figuring out where we are, I guess.
Yeah, there's the Lafayette, 9928 Lafayette, but it's white.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow, that looks good.
The owner sitting on the front porch. He doesn't live there, but he...
Oh, my gosh. Yeah.
He was... I think Fort Hood up in Texas is where he was in the military.
Oh, my gosh, yeah. Oh. I was afraid it was going to be a wreck.
Well, it was boarded up the last time we went by.
It looked real good on Google.
Told him that he would. I said, my father built this. Really?
The laundry chute's still there.
That's right. You remember that? I asked him if it was still there, and he said, yes, it's still there.
And that's where? What is that one?
What was that? That one was on Lafayette, wasn't it?
9928 Lafayette.
Have more of that.
That fellow, when he was in the military, saved his money and he bought a house. I don't remember where he said he paid $18,000 while he was still in the military. And he got in playing real estate. He bought this house too. He didn't live there. Then bought other houses, and then he would refurbish them and rent them out. And he's doing very, very well. I guess his brothers, I don't remember how many, and his maybe mother live in Austin, Texas. But I'm not sure how many relatives. Okay. Who went up there now? That's Kim, I think. Yeah, Kim went up there too. We were talking. I've forgotten his name already. Very friendly.
Then there was a nice family that lived next there, next door, Bushmans.
Yeah, that's right.
I don't remember anything about this place. That's before my memory time.
That was Kenneth. They had a boy named Kenneth, one child. The one that lived to the right of the house, facing the house, the one to the right.
Yes, Ovi. Kenneth Bowie, that's the one where you, something about the window?
Probably, but that was the next block playing baseball on the street, and that put a ball right through the window of one of the houses. But remember, Anderson's lived down further down, the last big house. And then there was Casper, David Casper.
Yes.
And then there was the one that had the boy Proudfoots. They had a boy that wasn't quite right, but they had a daughter too.
Yeah.
And you remember across the street, they had a, this was during the Second World War, that they had this little flag in the window with a gold star on it. The boy had been killed.
Where Dad set the fire.
Oh, yes. I don't know if you...
What?
I had a pair of roller skates, and I took... Everybody, kids had scooters. I didn't have a scooter. So I took a pair of roller skates, and I got a 2x4, and I nailed half... Took one skate apart, put half the skate in the back, and the other half in the front. So, like... And then I got an orange crate. I don't know. It was in the house someplace. And I nailed that to the front, and then I put two little... pieces of wood to hold onto this orange crate, and that was my scooter. I used to play with fire a lot. I don't know if you knew this, but
no.
It was terrible. Anyways, there were trees out in front. One was a maple tree, and I don't remember what the other one is. And one day, it was in the early fall. I don't think I was in school yet. And I was playing with matches, and all of a sudden, I realized I can get that orange crate to catch fire with matches. Wooden matches, you know. Yeah, and it started to burn, and I thought, this is really spectacular. Luckily, somebody drove by in a car and saw me sitting there watching this thing burn in this maple tree with a lot of dry leaves above it. So he stopped, went in and told Mom. She came out and rawr, 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 rawr. Dragged it away and put the hose on. I didn't think there was anything wrong. And remember, we had a bicycle. It had a little, that one bike had two wheelers and a very small wheel, about 8 inches. It was green. And
yeah,
you
that's
had,
where I learned to
yes,
ride
it's
a bike. You did too.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I couldn't learn on that big one. They thought it was a beautiful bike. But
she had a 24-inch girl's bike. But
yeah,
was,
but that. So that. Yeah.
Yeah, I inherited that one on
Bulls
Avenue.
You too? Yeah.
Yeah.
Somebody brought a grass skirt home from someplace, and that was on the bike. I don't know what relationship it has.
Yeah, I used to play hopscotch. Remember, you kids would play hopscotch. I was too little to do it, but you played hopscotch there. And Pop in 41 was sent up to Minnesota to build that Air Force base,
that's right.
The runways and all that, whatever it was.
Yeah.
And that's when he came back, he brought that Lionel train for me.
Yes, for you.
And I
thought
that was cool.
Yeah.
And you could only play with it at Christmas time.
Yeah.
It's under the tree.
But he and his friends played with it up in Minnesota before they brought it back. Now, I don't remember this, but Mom told me several times, she said, you're lucky to be alive. Several times. What I did, I took a nail file, because I saw them plug vacuum cleaners and other things into the wall, and there was a plug. And we had hot water heat now, so there was his radiators, and there was a plug by that. And I took this nail file, I've been about 4 or 5 years old, and I stuck it in there once. He said, and Mom asked the meter reader, you know, what happened? And he said, well, he was lucky that he wasn't touching the radiator.
Yeah.
And I thought, oh, that was spectacular.
You were a real pirate.
Oh, how terrible. And then they had, this was in the Second World War, and you couldn't get things. And they had an alarm clock. I remember that they would wind up every day, and it would go off, and that's how Pop got to work. And it was on a Sunday morning. It was just you and I. Diane was probably too small yet. Anyways, so I went in the room, and they were both sleeping. So I took this alarm clock, and I took it into the living room, and you were in there too. And I took a table knife, and I started taking this alarm clock apart. And I did. And, of course, after that, it didn't work. And then they got up, and they, you know, and then Pops put this clock on the floor in the living room. Screw over here, screw over here. I just remember you going like this that far. I don't know how they got on it, but they had to go look all over in South Chicago for a damn alarm clock.
It was on coals that you sat on the basement window, and then you fell back. And then
and broke the glass.
Yeah. You were busy.
Yeah, I tell you. Do you remember, too, in this house that Pop, he saw people had showers, and he put a shower in the basement. Remember the stairway?
Yes.
I don't know if it was a hose or what it is, but it came down.
Yeah, I kind of remember that. Yeah.
And do you remember, too, that sometime at Easter time or something, they bought us, I think you were big enough, chickens, little tiny chicks.
Yes.
And we put them in the oven in the basement.
Yeah. Well, you put them in the oven. Yeah.
Yeah, I remember that now.
When we first moved in there, Worcester had this, like a washing machine where you just move them, something back and forth. It's a big round.
It's a ringer washer. And you put those two ringer rollers and you put through there.
I don't remember that part.
It was next to the two tubs, and then she would get washed in there, and then Mom would make the rollers go one way so squeeze the water so it would go into the back into the washer, and then she'd put them in the tubs with the clear water and bring that thing around the other side and run it through from one tub to the other with clear water.
And they really had to work.
And then
she's
carried
let me
it
go
out.
Downstairs and play with it.
Remember the people upstairs? The post, he had a bicycle in the basement. He was a real cyclist. He would ride his bike all over, at least on the weekends. I don't think they have any kids. They're just
the two of them. That's right. And then when they did have one, then they had to get out.
I think that's
they
right.
Maybe the folks didn't.
Yeah, it's too hard for them to go up and down all the stairs for everything. Yeah.
I know the heat for the coal, so the upper level, the heat was controlled on the first level. So Mom determined how much heat they should get upstairs. And she was so afraid of this couple that moved in after Aunt Emma moved out, mm-hmm. the family. They had a new baby, so she cranked the heat way up. She said they had open windows upstairs, too.
Cool down. Most of the kids that I played with was the next block up. There was a lot of kids my age, roughly. And I remember one kid, and I never did this, but he did. We would ride no-handed, you know.
Oh, yeah.
But that was standard. But this kid got up and stood on the seat and rode the bike. He got the bike up to speed and then stood on the seat and went down the street. And I thought, that's crazy. And then he would slide down and get in. But I thought that was dumb. He would go maybe 20, 30 feet standing on the seat alone going down the street.
I remember our roller skates that fit on the shoe and you had to tighten them up yourself.
Yeah.
And you had to push the thing back and forth to get the right size.
Yeah. That's the kind I took apart to make the scooter out of it. Yeah.
And they come loose and they fall off.
And you remember they flooded the field down on 98 Lafayette? Pop and the other guys that lived in the neighborhood, they'd go down and open a fire hydrant and flood that field in the winter. But there was so much weeds, I don't think you could skate on it anyways. But that's where we'd go down to fly kites.
Maybe that's when they bought us skates. You got some skates, some ice skates. I remember I got some white ones, and you got brown ones.
Yeah.
We never learned to skate.
That's correct. But we said we had skates.
Yeah.
We didn't,
Mom bought me a pair of skates two sizes too big.
She knew you weren't going to use them either.
She tried to have me skate, but it didn't work. Things were that much too big.
Yeah.
She said I would grow into them. That was on Coles that happened.
Oh, when we lived down Indiana. We went to this Ellis Baldwin. She was a piano teacher.
Yes, I remember that now. Block over.
Yes, and I took piano lessons, and I think you did too, because I remember you were playing the little black car.
And she gave me the piano teacher gave me the little black car.
She gave it a little.
I don't know what happened to it. Probably worth a fortune. Yeah. I've forgotten that. And you remember there used to be the Mercy High School where the nuns? It's all gone.
Oh my gosh, yeah, that was Indiana.
Yeah. But it was a block square, and it was, remember the nuns would walk the kids down?
Yeah.
But that's all gone. There's apartment buildings now where that used to be.
Well, I remember on Coles Avenue, this school that we went to, grade school, Sullivan.
Yeah, W.K. Sullivan.
You graduated from their gym.
That's right. And the gym was on the third floor. That's exactly right. I forgot that.
Because I was in class and they said, you want to go up and watch your brother graduate? And I said, no, I'd rather be in their class. That'll walk me to school when I first started to. And you didn't like it. He'd walk me halfway and just say, keep going, I'm going to go find my friends that's on the other side. There's a grocery store in the corner too where you could get ice cream.
Yeah, Estelle's.
Yeah. Once a year she had a party and she gave away hot dogs and ice cream cones.
So yeah, she was nice. She was nice to the kids in the neighborhood.
That was the greatest thing when I could ride around the block with my bike, the two-wheeler. I felt like I was going away from home on vacation.
Yeah.
So which house are you on now?
Still
we're still talking.
Yeah.
Yes. We're back on Coles.
Yeah. No, I can see that.
Remember Junta's store, the grocery store at 9928?
Yes,
it was down on just about a block away. Yeah.
And I remember one time I went to get some Dixie rye bread. Usually I had to get like a loaf of rye bread and a half a pound of ground round. And anyway, when I was walking back, I decided I was going to walk backwards. And then, of course, I tripped and fell in the Yeah, it did not work. Yeah.
It stopped.
I think we got it.
I don't know if you remember there was where Estelle's was, the store on 8014 Coles, the one in there. There was Estelle's at the far end going towards W.K. Sullivan. There was this corner store named Estelle's. Do you remember? Yeah, she was very nice. That's the one that had her party. Anyways, if you went hers and then you went back two houses, but then there was an empty lot, a vacant lot.
Oh, this
and on that vacant lot, we built a little clubhouse once, but that's not part of the story that Kathy's talking about. In the winter, it was Tommy Rabarski, Safransky, and others. We would just hang around and on that lot because there was nobody's house, so we were in the front of the lot. And in the winter, when there'd be a lot of snow, we'd make snowballs and throw them and horse around. But if a truck went by on the street on Coles, we'd throw snowballs at the truck. Now, that was not a good thing, but that's what we did. So one day, I think there was three or four of us, and this truck was going with a lot of snow. It was not going very fast on the street, and we all started throwing snowballs. And it went boom, 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 and the guy stopped. And then he backed up, and we all split. And then he turned and drove through this empty lot, and we knew we were in trouble. So I ran down the alley, came around, hooked around, went in the Stell's store, took my jacket off, turned it inside out, and put it back on, and then went outside and stood like I didn't know a damn thing. And he just then hooked around the corner, and he looked at me, and I looked at him like I didn't know he would have known. And he looked at me. Not nice. What is this one?
So this is the one with the skull thing.
Oh, this is on Indiana.
Yeah.
Wasn't that 8048 Indiana?
Yeah.
Next to the Hunting's, a couple doors down?
Yes, that's right, yeah.
Where do you see the house that is on Indiana?
That was brick. That was a brick bungalow.
Yeah, brick bungalow, yeah. That's right. And then there was a lot next to it, all the way through the street. It was empty. But there's two houses there now.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
There it
goes.
And
that's when you got hit with
the arrow. Yeah, Gene. Here we go. was a house where they were telling them that a man died and they put this casket in the apartment and they had a wake in the apartment. But here we're going, this is... I couldn't figure out which one of those was Hunnings.
Did you get the one on 10445 Artesian?
Oh, 104, I thought it was 102.
No, 104,
no, we didn't.
45.
Oh, rats. No, we didn't. Sorry.
That's okay, I lived in it.
And I didn't recognize anything that looked like it. There it is. And there's the other house they built since. But look at, see if they can get a good look at what's in the windows of that house.
That's some kind of a foreign somewhere.
Bunch of skulls.
Oh. They must have built a room upstairs.
I think that's right, in the attic there.
That's weird, skulls.
Someone roll over in a grave, shooting that.
Yeah.
The house is in good shape. It's just
yes.
What's in those windows. It's telling them now to think about it. In Chicago, the amount of, at least at the time we lived there, they determine your water bill by how many faucets you have. And one day, the man, after they moved in, came by for the water, whatever it was, and asked about faucets. And the mom said, well, there's this one outside. And he looked, and then in the bathroom, there was one bathroom, and in the kitchen, and then downstairs, there was a wash tub. And he counted how many faucets. He says, okay. And I was kind of walking around watching. I said, yeah, there's one out in the garage.
Oh.
And mom looked at me like, you're crazy, you know. And he said, well, go out and check. You know, she went out, and she opened the garage door on the side, and he went in, and sure enough, over in the corner, there was this pipe coming up with a faucet, I guess, so you could wash your car in the garage.
Yeah.
Mom didn't thank me for telling me. Yep.
Did we do all the houses?
No.
Oh.
10445 Artesian.
That's the one we're missing.
Yeah.
Did we go there?
No, yeah. But I could tell you about it.
Sure.
Yeah, you live there.
I was thinking it was 102. Remember when we couldn't see it? But it was one. Diane points out it was 104.
Well, we didn't go to the house.
No,
that
we didn't go to 104.
About.
Well, I still have.
So she could just tell
dozen.
Stories without
okay.
us looking at it.
Yeah, remember the ceiling came down?
Yeah. That was when we were living there.
Yeah.
The reason they bought the house was because of the doorbell. It didn't have one you pushed, you turned the hang, and a little crank, and it made a little music. And Mom liked that, so that was her house. And they tried to sell the one on 1643, and they couldn't. And they were going to sell that one to the other one, but they already bought the other one. And since I was getting married, they said, you live there. So
yeah.
We rented it. And then Dad would come over, and he put a back porch on.
Mm-hmm.
He enlarged it. It was just open, and I don't know how to explain it, just windows and so forth. So he enclosed it, so our kitchen got bigger.
Yeah.
And before that, we had one of those breakfast nooks where you have the two benches you sit on with the table
yeah.
in the middle,
yeah.
and the kitchen was real small. And then he opened it up, so he'd be over working on the house, and one time the whole back was open, and I was looking.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Tony worked nights, so it was dark outside, and he was open. It was scary. But anyway, once they did move in, Mom used to do quilting in the basement. She'd sew up the top and whatever you want to call it, put like a sandwich together, and then they put it on a frame that Dad made, and her two sisters would come over, and they'd go in and out with their needles. So that's the way they'd spend, but only one day. One day a week. So mom would be down there working at night by herself or in the afternoon. It's real nice. And that's when they had the first color television. They were over at Tony's parents for dinner once, and they had a color television. So now mom and dad had to get one. And that's where they had a party to Dad's 65th birthday in the basement.
Yeah.
And all their friends over. And he put a bathroom downstairs. They had a toilet when we first moved in. Nothing around it, just the toilet that worked. So he built the, out of, what do you call it, blocks, cinder blocks, whatever. So he built that around the toilet, put in the shower. So they had their bathroom downstairs. And you and Nancy slept down there. I don't remember what it was. You came for a visit, maybe it was for the party?
I think that's right. I've forgotten what you just said. Yes, yes, that's right.
We asked if it was cold or bugs down there, and Nancy said, oh no, we had a perfect time.
Yeah, that's right.
In the garage in the back, they rented out to a furniture place across the alley. So they had extra money coming in that way.
When he first got it, there was an electric range in the kitchen, and Pop wanted to take that out, so he went and turned off, he thought, all the power. And then, I don't know what happened, but the power for the range wasn't off. And I remember he did, and I was right next to him. We both could have got killed. Anyways, he did something with the screwdriver, and all of a sudden this big flash. And I don't know, and he looked at me, his eyes were, I figured that expression, those eyes were really big, like, what in the world? But he didn't say anything. And we both caught ourselves. Found out there was another switch for the 220 line, and we just kicked all the 110s. But I wasn't the one that turned it off. He was the one that did it. So,
Uncle Alvin painted the house before we moved in.
But you remember there was a plaster that plastered the whole ceiling, and you were going to have a party in there before you moved
in? No, we were just walking around cleaning the place up.
And then it came down?
Yeah, Mom and Dad put carpeting down
on
the floor. And then it just came down. Tony was walking underneath it, and he just missed it. Just, you could see a saucer coming down all in one piece.
This is a plaster ceiling in a big room.
Yeah, they were just fixing it by putting another coating on top of it because of the cracks. That was interesting.
Yes, I can imagine.
And the bathroom was a horrible color, so Tony went and got some paint that sticks to plastic tile, and he painted the bathroom. We now had a pink bathroom.
I remember sanding the floor, and they had rented a sander. We were sanding the floor. Yeah.
Actually, some people were living there before I got married, and he used to sell ice cream. I worked for a place that delivered ice cream, and he'd bring ice cream containers over to the house on 93rd instead of, then he'd drop off the check there for the rent. And one day he kept calling saying, we have no heat.
What?
So mom and dad went over and they checked the house, and dad checked the furniture. There wasn't anything wrong with it. Under the thermostat, they had put a table with a lamp on it.
The heat of the lamp. I remember this now that you told me. I remember that.
They didn't keep the house very clean either. When we moved in, there was an inch of dirt on the shower curtain. No exaggeration, it was. So it was really dirty. And I think that's the reason why they wanted to put new floor in. Or carpeting, rather.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah, I'd forgotten about the thermostat, but when you said it, then I remember Pop telling me they had the light on me.
Yeah, that was a very interesting place. Lots of memories for me.
Yeah.
It was fun because Aunt Emma and Uncle Louie went with, and Uncle Louie can do anything. And Betty was there too.
Yeah.
I remember she wanted to take a bath, so she went into this lake, and she said the water was clear, and she's crying herself.
Yeah.
She had her bathing suit on or something. She was taking her bath. We had a hunt for blueberries, too.
Yeah, blueberries. I remember that.
Taking blueberries home. Yeah. I didn't have a container to put the blueberries in, and I felt kind of bad, so I stripped the bark off a perch tree and made
a scoop.
Yeah. That's what I was using.
And there was a man that raised up there named Timonen that they were friends with. He worked for the Edison like Uncle Louie did. And I remember that Timonen's house was the first house to have fluorescent lights in the ceiling. He put it in the kitchen. And when Pop saw that, Pops did it for one of the houses, and I don't remember which one. But that was spectacular to have a long tube that glowed and made the whole room light up. And they had two boys. I remember their names.
Leo and... I remember they had National Geographic.
And what else do you remember about LaBelle?
Well, going back a little bit, I remember when Pop, I think, came from Minnesota when he was working up there and he came back, he brought ornaments that were made out of plastic. And I remember we went over, all of us went over to Uncle Louie's house. And Auntie Emma was there, and Pop says, look at these beautiful, it was a red one, look at this beautiful red ornament that we just got up, whatever. And he was giving it to her, just as she would take it, he dropped it. And of course, it didn't break, but up to that, every time an ornament you had was glass, it would break, remember? And he just thought that was so fun.
Speaking of Christmas and ornaments, he had a magazine article where he had things that show off lights or something like that, or sparkly, and then turn the tree off, and it was there. And Mom ordered them, and they were just cardboard pieces with some stuff on the outside. And she was so mad. I can't even think anymore about what it was.
I remember another story in 99, when we lived in Lafayette. I remember Mom saying that the tree was, at Christmas, remember, the needles kept falling down and she had to keep sweeping. And I thought, why don't you get them before they fall? So I took the carpet sweeper and going up and down the tree.
Yeah, I remember that.
Of course, the tree had been hung with tinsel and glass ornaments and all that.
You were thinking all the time,
I can fix this. Why wait till they fall?
You just have a sense of curiosity. Yeah. I remember once I thought they had taken a coffin out of the one on Coles Avenue. You told me, no, I was wrong. That was a piece of furniture. You took out the front window.
Yeah, you thought they had a coffin upstairs. No.
Somebody say something so I can think of something else.
I was thinking when we went up to Lock Up all that one time, that was when we had Kenny with me. You know, he was so sick, but the doctor said, you know, we were wondering if we should take him up there. And the doctor said that it would be hard on him, but we should go. And we did. And that's when I had a picture with all the kids on the step, and Dad was holding Kenny. And I just was so glad to have that picture.
Yeah. Do you remember the first time we went to Lac La Belle, Pop had that 37 Pontiac, gray one, and Uncle Louie had a green one, and they met at 95th and State Street.
To go,
There was a tavern there, and they met there, and I think Timonen was met there, too. That was sort of a meeting place, and then we took off, and I don't remember after that, but I just remember it was dark outside early in the morning. And then Pop was driving, and something failed on that Pontiac. I think it was the coil. We were way the heck up in the boom, probably in Michigan by then. And they had to stop at a guy had to go in someplace to get another coil to put on the car. This was 6 volts. I think that's what it was. I know there was something failed in the electrical ignition part, and I think it was the coil.
Well, did you guys remember the sound, the Sandman?
Singing Sands. Remember at Lac La Belle when we went down to where Lac La Belle goes into Lake Superior, there was a sandy place there. And we would take a stick and go round and round and round and go, wah, wah, wah. And Timonen was the one that told us about it, the Singing Sands. Do you remember?
I didn't know about it until I heard you talking about it a little earlier.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
What about the story involving a group of friends that went with you to go get a quart of milk? And you were kind of in a hurry to get the milk.
I don't remember now.
There was some question.
Oh, that was when we lived on 8014 Coles. Yeah. This friend, he's long since died, John Shelius, myself, Edgar Ellinghausen, and McGiffin, we were in this car. I should back out. John Shelius' father worked in the steel mill, and he had a pretty good position there, and they had a two-door Cadillac, green, with the fins in the back and all this. And his mother, we were at Shelius' house, said, John, we need to get some milk, a quart of milk. He says, okay. So we got all in this car, and John drove a little fast. And the place to get the milk was in a liquor store, because all the other stores were closed, it was late. So what happened? John, and maybe McGiffin, I'm not sure, but at least one of them, but two of them, I think, ran across, he parked the car on 79th Street, ran across the street, went in the liquor store, came out with his bag, jumped in the car, and took off. Well, the cops were sure we had robbed the place. So all of a sudden, and about two blocks down, John couldn't understand why this cop was behind him making all this noise and the lights flashing, so he pulled over, and they pulled over in front of him right away. Out of the car, so we all had to get out, hands on the wall, so we all would stand at this front of the store with our hands on the wall. And then they went and looked in the car and the bag, and there was a quart of milk. I said, don't drive so fast, or something like that, they said. But I suspected them, it really looked like someone was holding up the story. You know, these two young kids run in, come running out, jump in the car, and take off. Carrying the small bag. Yeah.
That cash.
Weren't we on a fishing trip somewhere and you were out on a lake and you caught a muskie?
So
by yourself?
Oh, yeah, that was the Lac La Belle.
That was Lac La Belle too?
Yeah. Yeah.
I remember it was an inch too short and Mom hurried up and cleaned it so you didn't have to.
Oh, there's one other Lac La Belle story. My dad, Uncle Louie, and myself were in this rowboat. We rowed around, we were coming back, and just before you get back to where you tie the rowboat up at the dock there, about a half a block, there's a lot of seaweeds growing, whatever you call them, large weeds in the water. And one of the friends, his sweet tooth, I can't remember, he has daughters with and wife. He hid there, and he knew we were coming back, and he threw rocks, and it was splash. And Uncle Louis said, there's a fish in there. So stop, because I was one of those rowers. Stop. Okay, so they took off their rocks. I remember, they were just working. He threw another rock a little further down. No, it's over there. Then he threw it over there. I know, he told us later, he was just laughing so hard, he couldn't hurt his dance go. Anyways, and so Uncle Louie was going like that and rolling, and then it jammed out and he says, give me your rod, so I gave him my rod. They were just working just crazy. Well, they didn't catch anything because there was none there to catch. They kept snagging on the weeds and all the rest. And finally they said, okay, we're not going to catch anything. So we rolled back in and tied up. And the fellow that was doing that met us at the pier with a straight face. Did you catch anything? Oh. I can't remember his name. I see his face. Oh, God. Anyways, they said no, and he said, then he told them that he was the one throwing the rocks and making the little splashes in the water.
There was something, I'm back on Coles Avenue, and when Uncle lived upstairs, he had some type, somehow he had a mouse, a dead mouse, and he did something to Mary Lou or Betty. I can't remember what it was. He scared them something awful.
No, I don't know.
It was a box or something, and he sent, oh, it was, now I got it. It was a toolbox, He put the dead mouse in it, and then he closed it up, and he went upstairs, and he had his daughters, one of them, go down and get him a screwdriver. So when they opened the box, he just screamed. Yeah.
Man.
Yep.
What other things did he do?
Well, I tell you one that Betty did. He worked for the Edison, and he drove this Edison car back and forth, and they had that green Pontiac that was in the garage. Well, Betty and Mary Lou and Ruby, Betty talked them into saying that she could drive that car, and she was going to take them for a ride. Then the mother was gone, and the other uncle was gone, so it was just the three girls at home. So they went out, opened the garage door, Betty got in and fired up the car, and just going to go, and the alley wasn't that wide, and there was a telephone pole, so you had to be a little careful. And she got the car jammed crosswise in the alley, and she couldn't go backwards or forwards. Well, there was the car. So what did they do? They shut the garage door, turned off the car, and went and hid in the attic. Of course, when Auntie Emma came home, she didn't know there was a garage, you know, the car was halfway jammed in the alley. And Uncle Louis parked the other car in front, and they didn't know either. And they wondered, where are the girls? You know, where are they at? Well, it came dinner time, still nobody there. And finally, I think Ruby had to go down and go to the bathroom, so she came down and said, well, where were you? She said, what's there? And then, where's your sisters? What's there? And they came down, why are you up there? And I think Betty was, or Mary Lou, I don't know, but it wasn't Ruby, told them the car is stuck in the alley. Of course, I'm really looking at it, we're talking about the car stuck in the alley. And boy, they catch hell for that. Oh, one other time. Betty wouldn't come home at a reasonable hour, and she was on a date. Do you remember? So Uncle Louie, inside the front door, stacked a whole pile of pots, big pile. And so when she opened the door, bam, 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 bam.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, he was a character.
He would tell stories about Fido. Or
yeah, Fido.
Trying
to get us to go to sleep.
Yeah, just, you know, whatever makeup stories he had about that dog.
Yeah, I've forgotten those. That's right. It thought was a real hero the whole time. So it saved somebody.
Yeah.
When there was a lot of people over the house and the folks wanted us to go to sleep, and then he would come in and while we were in bed and tell us a fight, he would lie down with one and tell us a Fido story or two. But we, okay, that was it. We'd go to sleep.
Yeah.
You know what's going to happen? When we leave here and go home, we're going to think of a whole bunch of those.
Yes, exactly right.